Hi there, I'm Mary Kokel, one of the fine art photographers at the Harvard Art Museums, and I wanted to thank Diana and Chloe from the Harvard Museum of Science and Culture for inviting me to talk today. I'd like to share a very low-tech photo project that I make from my garden. It's called Anthotype, and it's a very slow, cameraless photographic process. What is an anthotype? It's from the Greek, meaning flower print. It's a 19th century photographic process. Juices are extracted from plants to create handmade photosensitive papers. And then the prints are exposed to the summer sun and bleached out. It's an ephemeral process. The image cannot be fixed. Anthotype was discovered by British scientist Sir John Herschel, who's better known for inventing the cyanotype process and photofixer. He referred to it as phytotype, or vegetable photograph. It was an early attempt at color photography. This image was made from red stock flowers, and it's from the photo history book, Out of the Shadows. Here's another example of an anthotype made by Herschel, and this was made from crimson poppies, and it's about 180 years old. It's interesting how the red poppy flower yields a different color when its juice is extracted. I found this to be true from some of the plants in my own garden as well. Here's my test palette of all the plants that I tested last year, mostly from my garden. Some were foraged from the wild. This series of color patches is a record of what's growing in my garden and helps me to monitor any future color fading. I found that some of the best emulsions came from irises, roses, sugar snap peas, black raspberries, and morning glories. Here's a list of the very simple supplies you will need to make an anthotype. First of all, sunshine, plenty of summer sun. Also, you'll need some watercolor or Reeves BFK printmaking paper, any kind of paper that can take water. You'll want a flat or foam brush, preferably around 3 inches wide, some cheesecloth and a strainer, a hand blender or mortar and pestle, a bowl, rubbing alcohol, which will help extract the color out of the flowers, gloves, newsprint to keep the surface nice and clean, and lastly, a contact frame. And for those of you from the darkroom days, you might have an old contact printer, or people can also make one from a simple board with the same size plexi and using some binder clips. Plants that you'll need. If you don't have a garden, there are plenty of edibles that you can get from the market or the garden, those are beets, spinach, blackberries, sugar snap peas, and cranberries all work very well. If you do have a garden or know a gardener, flowers from the garden that work are blue irises, red roses, magenta rhododendron, morning glory, and dahlias. And just a word of caution, be careful what you use in case you're allergic to certain plants, and also be aware of which common plants could actually be toxic if consumed. Research the plants that you intend to use and be sure to wear gloves. Here's my simple testing process. Blooms are collected from my small urban garden, and the amount of paper I would coat was dependent on whatever the garden had that day. Here, a dark purple iris flowers were collected into a bowl, crushed using a pestle, and adding a dash of rubbing alcohol, and then strained. And as I mentioned earlier, be sure to wear gloves because some plants can be toxic and the rubbing alcohol can also dry your skin out. And the two pictures down below, picture of iris juice and rose juice. And here is a quick time lapse video of my process working in the corner of my kitchen, working with a dark purple iris. You see like a few dozen flowers are going to be used. Rubbing alcohol, handheld blender. Now I put on the gloves because I'm going to be handling that material. And then you can just squeeze it out by hand, and then the cheesecloth is retaining the debris. Here is another time-lapse video of coating the anthotype paper. First, I mark the back just to keep accurate notes of what day I'm making the paper. And I'm taking a flat brush, applying the iris juice in one coat, and then you want to let it dry before you apply the second coat. So here I'm doing about 4 pieces of paper that day. And when you do let the paper dry, make sure you do that in subdued light away from sunlight. But it's not like cyanotype where you need to keep it totally out of UV light. It can take a little bit, but just keep it in a slightly darkened room. And here is another time lapse just of applying the third coat. And I thought that by adding 3 coats, I finally got a nice color that I liked. So just keep going with additional coats until you get a really nice deep color on the paper. Here's a picture, an example of some of the finished papers before exposure. This is rose paper, iris paper, and sugar snap pea coated papers. And after you do your coating, you want to store them in a dark bag in the refrigerator is best. And then we place them inside the contact printer. Here I have an old contact printer and then a couple of handmade ones. Like I mentioned before, it's a board with same size plexi, closing it off with binder clips. And then you place it in the direct, nice hot summer sun. Exposures can take up to a few hours to several days, depending on the paper. And when the background becomes faded, that means the print is ready. And here's a time lapse of just the anthotypes spending a whole day in the summer sun. So here's an example of a pressed hydrangea plant that was used to make an anthotype. You can see what it looks like on the right when it comes out of the sunshine. The background has become faded. That's how I know the print is done. And then you can see that the plant has actually become quite toasted sitting in the summer sun for a couple of days. And I like to reuse these actually. They do pretty well. Now, since anthotypes are not permanent, they will fade over time. The print should not be washed like a cyanotype because it will wash away and you'll completely lose your image. The finished print can be very faint. Therefore, I like to scan the image into Photoshop and make a more permanent digital record of the work. I will add a slight contrast curve to bring out the details, and I'm just using a regular flatbed scanner here. Here's a picture of the actual iris plant on the left that made this particular emulsion. Anthotype is a very patient process. It may take several tries to get a successful image. Here's an example of multiple coats of iris emulsion. I allowed for the first thin coat to show through the other coatings on top for a layered look. I like the imperfect handmade look of multiple coatings. This particular image was a 3-day exposure. Here are sugar snap peas growing in a container on the left. The tendrils and leaves are edible, but a bit fibrous, but they make an excellent green emulsion. And this happens to be an anthotype of willow, birch, and thyme. This is a pressed milkweed plant made on sugar snap pea paper. Here are dark red roses that made this paper. Roses tend to yield a thicker emulsion, thereby requiring a longer time in the sun. But it does make a great color. Here's another example of rose paper with rose as the subject, some pressed roses on top. This picture was made with foraged wild black raspberry paper. The berries were a bit too tart to eat, but they make an excellent emulsion and produce this really nice two-tone effect of purple and blue. And here again is the pressed milkweed plant that I like to reuse. And this was made on black raspberry paper. Morning Glory is another nice flower. However, use with caution. It's also a toxic flower. But here's a picture of it on the left. And it's also an example of how a blue flower will produce like this, a very different looking emulsion. And here it made like this nice mauve, reddish kind of color. And this is an anthotype of Queen Anne's lace and tulips and thyme. And this is on Morning Glory paper. Here's one of my favorite plants, a wonderful dark purple dahlia, which blooms at the end of summer, starting like in August up until the first frost. And it made this wonderful purplish emulsion with like some yellow highlights. I found that very intriguing to get a two-tone picture out of it. And these are ginkgo leaves. Here's another example of that purple dahlia paper. And the pressed plant on here is Morning Glories. This was made, I think, back in October. So by this time, the sunlight is really fading. So this was probably sitting in the sunlight whenever I could get it, probably for at least a week or two. And it's still a very faded image. And here's some resources that I'd like to highly recommend. I love the anthotype book on the left. This is an excellent resource. It's a step-by-step guide for making anthotypes. Plus it includes over 100 illustrations of different plants that people from all over the world have tried and submitted to the author. And on the right is an excellent book of alternative photographic processes, which includes anthotype, and also dozens of other very interesting processes in case you're interested in more handmade photographic things. And I am on Instagram if you're interested and you want to scroll through my feed. Back in February of this year, I posted tons of anthotype examples. And thank you very much for tuning in.